Indeed, it is only the knowledgeable among his servants who truly fear Allah. Middle Path Radio, your source of Islamic knowledge.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala Rasulillah. Wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Wa alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. Jazakumullahu khairan for inviting me to come over here, inshallah, and remind you and remind myself first and foremost about some of the important aspects of A'immatul Arba'a or A'immatul Deen, the Imams of the religion, because that's really how they should be addressed and that's how they should be known in reality. And inshallah, we might come across some aspects or some segments in relation to their virtues. You're going to start knowing, subhanAllah, how virtuous they are in the sight, not only of all the Muslims, but even in the sight of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prophesy about A'immatul Arba'ah? Did he mention them in a hadith? We're going to come across this bi'idhnillah. The reason why I think this is an important topic is when Imam An-Nawawi alayhi rahmatullah was writing, okay, he was writing his muqaddimah or his introduction to his commentary of in Sahih Muslim. In this introduction he said, and he was quoting the earlier scholars, Sufyan al-Thawri, Sufyan ibn Uyayna and others, he said, alayhi rahmatullah, عِنْدَ ذِكْرِ الصَّالِحِينَ تَنْزِلُ الرَّحْمَةِ. It means when the righteous people are mentioned, the mercy of Allah descends. So by mentioning these names, we are asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to have mercy upon us. And this is something known in the religion. That's why Imam An-Nawawi alayhi rahmatullah, when he was writing the Asanid, the chain of narrators when it came to knowledge of hadith, he would write all of them with their full names, with their lineage. And he used to do his silsila or his chain like this in order to extract and to mention them by name so that people can start learning who these people are. And that, so as the early scholars, they used to say of the Salaf or the early Muslims, ذِكْرَ الصَّالِحِينَ, or rather they said, sorry, عِنْدَ ذِكْرِ الصَّالِحِينَ تَنْزِلُ الرَّحْمَةِ. By mentioning these names, we hope Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends down His mercy upon us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He Himself mentions and He says, لَقَدَ كَانَ فِي قِصَصِهِمْ عِبَرَةٌ لِأُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ. Indeed, in these stories, you will find an eye-opener for people who are مِنْ أُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ, people of deep thought, people of knowledge, people who can understand, people of comprehension. They will be the ones who can actually appreciate what we're going to be talking about, inshallah. The first person and the first individual, scholar, imam, hafiz, I want to speak about is Abu Hanifata radiallahu anhu. Abu Hanifata al-Nu'man ibn Thabit al-Kufi alayhi rahmatullah. He was born in the year 80 and he died in the year 150. Imam Shafi alayhi rahmatullah said something amazing about him. He said about him, من أراد أن يتبحر في الفقه فهو عيال على أبي حنيفة. Meaning, anybody, whoever wants to participate in this knowledge, whoever wants to become an illuminary in knowledge of fiqh, if you want to become something when it comes to knowledge of fiqh, then you are always going to be a child in the presence of who? Imam Abu Hanifa. Huwa Imam al-A'zam. He is the greatest of all of the A'imma. The number one when it comes to knowledge of fiqh, no one could ever surpass someone the likes of Imam Abu Hanifa alayhi rahmatullah. Some of the ulama, they said about him that he was to be considered of the tabi'een, meaning the generation that came straight after the sahaba. Why was this? قال بعض العلماء, some of the ulama, they said, يُعَدُّ أَبُو حَنِيفَةَ مِنَ التَّابِعِينَ. Imam Abu Hanifa should be considered from the tabi'een, the generation that came after the sahaba. Why? فَقَدْ لَقِيَ عَدَدًا مِنَ الصَّحَابَةِ, because he met and he lived up to the time in which he actually met many of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Minhum, amongst them was Anas ibn Malik. Imam Abu Hanifa, it was mentioned in some narrations that he met Anas ibn Malik radiyallahu anhu wa arda. Wa kana ma'rufan bil wara. He was known to be somebody of devout faith, وَكَثْرَةِ الْعِبَادَةِ and much worship. So he used to worship Allah constantly. وَالْوَقَارِ he was very, very calm and had sakina and tranquility about him. وَالْإِخْلَاسِ he had sincerity. وَقُوَّةِ الشَّخْصِيَةِ and he had a very strong personality. لَا يَخَافُ فِي اللَّهِ لَوْمَةَ لَائِمٍ he never used to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when it came to speaking the truth. And this you will come to know inshaAllah what happened or what transpired to him during the end of his life. The ulama they mention and they say about him, كَانَ يَعْتَمِدُ عَلَى سِتَّةِ مَصَادِرِ his ijtihadat, his fatawa, his opinions, the masail that he delved into, all of the reference point for all of his ijtihadat and all of his knowledge are from six sources. Ulama they mention about him. Al-awwal, number one, is Al-Qur'an al-Karim. So the first point of reference, if you want to know anything about Abu Hanifa and where he extracts most of his knowledge from and his masail when he's doing his ijtihad, you should know that the first point of reference for him was always the Qur'an. Secondly, it was a sunnah al-nabawiyyah. Sunnah al-Nabawiyyah, meaning the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Also, al-Ijma'. Al-Ijma' means when the ulama of a certain time period come to a consensus and they all agree on something to be correct or incorrect, that will take a legislative ruling. So that is something which is known as a hujjah or an evidence in our religion. That's something that he himself incorporated and utilized alayhi rahmatullah whenever, and he would take that into consideration whenever he would discuss anything pertaining to sharia, anything pertaining to halal, anything pertaining to haram. Similarly, al-qiyas or analogy. We don't have a certain ruling, we have a certain mas'ala, some issue came up, but we don't have any reference point from the Qur'an, we don't have a reference point from the sunnah, we don't have any reference point whatsoever from anywhere, not a statement made about this by any of the sahaba, radiyallahu anil jami'. So what does he do? He sees and he analyzes if there's any other mas'ala or any other ruling very similar to this. So there's mushabaha, there's a similarity and there's a similitude. If the similitude exists and the illa and the legal reasoning exists, then he takes that ruling and he applies it to this mas'ala in which there's no Qur'an and there's no sunnah. That's something in which the Prophet ﷺ himself did during his lifetime, alayhi salatu wasalam. Al-istihsan is something that he would utilize also in his madhab. Also al-urf wal-'ada. Al-istihsan meaning the sharia aslan. What's the asl of the sharia? Our religion now that we have before us, the asl is always that what? Anything which is hasan, that is good, then it is halal automatically. Anything which is qabih, ugly, deformed, automatically it's considered to be haram. And that's when you don't find a nas, meaning you don't find anything from Quran, anything from sunnah. So this is known as istihsan. Also al-urfi wal-'ada, what is the customary traditions of the people who exist at that time. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa hadith collected by Imam Ahmad in his musnad. This was also mentioned, some of the ulama they consider that it's not a hadith said by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself, but it is mawquf. Really, it was said by Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu anhu. And that's more correct. So if we were to attribute it to Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he would have said, مَنْ رَآهُ الْمُسْلِمُونَ حَسَنْ فَهُوَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ حَسَنْ. Anything that the Muslims they view and they judge to be good in its nature, then Allah views that thing also as being good. So that's also a primary asl or a primary foundational principle that Imam Abu Hanifa alayhi rahmatullah took great consideration in when he would pass fatawa, when he would base any of his opinions on these issues. Jalaluddin al-Suyuti, he has a book and he mentions alayhi rahmatullah in one of his ta'lifat speaking about Imam Abu Hanifa. And he says that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned Imam Abu Hanifa. Imagine that. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned Imam Abu Hanifa radiyallahu anhu wa rahimahullahu ta'ala. Imam Jalaluddin al-Suyuti, he said, قَدْ بَشَّرَ النَّبِيُّ sallallahu alayhi wa sallam بِالْإِمَامِ أَبِي حَنِيفَ. Indeed, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spoke about Imam Abu Hanifa. في الحديث الذي أخرجه أبو نعيم في الحلية. In the narration which was collected by Abu Nu'aym in his Hilya. This hadith, the asal is from Sahih Muslim. So it's an authentic hadith. Where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, لو كان العلم بالثرياء, if knowledge itself was left on planets outside of this earth, on planets, some of the ulama they say meaning stars, some they say planets. He said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, لَتَنَاوَلَهُ رِجَالٌ مِنْ أَبْنَاءِ فَارِسِ. Indeed, one of the sons of the children of Faris, meaning the Persians, would go and attain that knowledge. Because Imam Abu Hanifa alayhi rahmatullah, for anybody who knows, he was Persian in origin. He wasn't an Arab. He was from the Persian people. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned this, Jalaluddin al-Suyuti and many of the imma, including al-Dhahabi, they all have prophesied this to be a hadith speaking about who? Imam Abu Hanifa radiyallahu anhu arda. So you can already begin to understand and appreciate that the religion that they formulated or they codified, you have to realize that Imam Abu Hanifa didn't come with anything from his own self. Now, when you understand the madrasa of Imam Abu Hanifa or the madrasa of Ahlul Ra'i or Ahlul Fiqh, where do they get this tradition from? Because we know that Imam Abu Hanifa radiallahu anhu, whenever he wanted to talk about any masail, what he would do is he would debate it and he would talk to his students. And if there was no evidence from Quran and Sunnah, he would still make a ruling in relation to that. Where did he get that tradition from? Is it something that came from his own self? Or did it come from the time of the Sahaba? Was there any of the Sahaba who used to do the same thing? Or Abu Hanifa, inherited that tradition from? Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu was just the same. For those people who don't know, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu arda was the first of the companions to make a judgment about a ruling in which he didn't use anything from Quran and anything from the Sunnah. Somebody came to him asking him about a mas'ala pertaining to inheritance. So he said, Wallahi arahu an yakuna al jawab kada wa kada. He said, I assume that the answer will be this and that. I don't have any nas, I don't have anything specific from Quran and from the Sunnah, but I assume that it will be this and that. Who was the first person to do that? Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu arda. And his student, al Nakhai, he inherited that tradition from Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu. And Abu Hanifa radiallahu anhu inherited that from al-Nakhai, because that was the student of the student of the student. Of who? Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu. Because later on you know that Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he moved to where? Kufa, the place where Imam Abu Hanifa was born. So he inherited that tradition from who? Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu arda. Imam al-Shafi'i, he mentioned something important about Abu Hanifa. He said, Su'ila Malik ibn Anas. Malik ibn Anas, who's Malik ibn Anas? Does anybody know who Malik ibn Anas was? Malik ibn Anas, alayhi rahmatullah, was Imam Malik, that was his name. Malik ibn Anas, al-Madani. He mentioned and he said, somebody asked him, Hal ra'ayta Abu Hanifa? Have you ever seen Abu Hanifa in your life? Hal ra'ayta Abu Hanifa? Have you ever seen Abu Hanifa? Somebody asked him that. Imam Malik said, and he said, وَنَاظَرْتُهُ. And have you ever come in and said, because your traditional found principles are a bit different, did that cause any friction or anything like that? Did you ever have a discussion? He said, we had a discussion. نَعَمْ رَأَيْتُ رَجُلًا. He goes, I saw a man. لَوْ نَظَرَ. If he would see, or if it were to be seen, إِلَى هَذِهِ السَّارِيَةِ. Meaning, if he was to see a pillar made out of stone, من حجارة فقال إنها من ذهب. And if he was to say that it was made out of gold, we can clearly see that it's out of stone. But if he was to say that it was made out of gold, لقام بحجته, he would bring evidence to support his stance. Meaning he was so strong in articulation, bringing evidence, bringing hujja, that he would be able to convince you today that this wall right there is actually gold. It's not even made out of stone. That's how strong he was, alayhi rahmatullah, when it comes to producing and establishing evidence and proof. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses these people from a knowledge from himself. Okay? Allah subhanahu is the reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed many of the madhahib to stay with us till today, and many of the madhahib of the past have become extinct. How many of you know that there were many madhahib that existed many long time ago that have become extinct? What happened to the madhab of Layth ibn Sa'ad? What happened to the madhab of Abu Thawr? What happened to the madhab of Az-Za'farani? What happened to the madhab of Al-Awza'i? What happened to the madhab of all of these a'immah? They don't exist anymore. Only the four are left till today. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of a wisdom that He knows from Himself, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose this because of knowledge min indihi, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that He allowed and He permitted these to remain while the others went. One day, it was mentioned about Abu Hanifa radiyallahu anhu, or alayhi rahmatullah, da'a Abu Ja'far al-Mansur. Does anybody know who Abu Ja'far al-Mansur was? Abu Ja'far al-Mansur. Nobody knows anything about Islamic history. Abu Ja'far al-Mansur was the Khalifa at the time when he lived. Okay? Abu Ja'far al-Mansur. So Abu Ja'far al-Mansur, he made a decree that was to compel Abu Hanifa to take the judge, to be a judge. He has to take that role, as it's going to be his job. But he refused. Imtana'a. Ulama say imtana'a, he refused. Wa aba, completely refused. He said, no, it's not going to be for me. I'm not going to take that job. And then it was said, hatta, until he was forced, duriba, he was beaten, wasujin, and he was forced to go into prison. He refused, he didn't want to take that role. He felt that that was not befitting for him to take that role, even though he was probably, out of everybody who lived in his time, the one who was the most worthy of taking that position. But subhanallah al-azim, out of wara, out of being somebody who was very close to Allah, he didn't feel that about himself, so he refused. They said, you refuse? Okay, we're going to take you to prison. And then he was beaten and he was tortured. Some of the ulama, they mention and they say, some of the riwayat and the narration say, so much so, مات محبوسا. He died in prison. How many of you knew that about Abu Hanifa radiallahu anhu? That he died in a prison cell. This is something that many of the ulama, they say. Some of the ulama, they say, مات محبوسا. He died in prison. Some, they say, مات محبوسا بالسم. He died in prison because he was poisoned. Some, they say, he died in prison because of excessive beating. Subhanallah. Some people, because he didn't want to take that job role. Imagine. And some, they say, he died straight after being released, بعد خروجه في منزلته, in his house. Soon after he was released, for not too long after that, in his house, he died, عليه رحمة الله, in the year 150. By the way, which was the same year that Imam Shafi'i was born. So Abu Hanifa died the same year that Imam Abu Hanifa, the Imam Shafi'i was born the same year Imam Abu Hanifa رضي الله عنه passed away. If you want any references to anything that I mentioned, read the book called مناقب أبي حنيفة, The Virtues of Abu Hanifa, وصاحبيه, and his two companions. The book was written by Imam al-Dhahabi, عليه رحمة الله. Also, there's a book called Abu Hanifa, written by Abu Zuhra. So these are the main references, inshallah, if you want to learn more about who Abu Hanifa رضي الله عنه was. So you can already understand from his legacy that he was a legacy of knowledge, alayhi rahmatullah. Where does Imam Malik fit into the picture? Imam Malik, alayhi rahmatullah, Malik ibn Anas, ibn Malik, al-Madini, born in the year 93, passed away in the year 179. Imam Shafi'i said about him, alayhi rahmatullah, إِذَا ذُكِرَ الْعُلَمَاءُ, when the scholars are mentioned, فَمَالِكُ النَّجْمُ, Imam Malik is the star in the sky. وَمَالِكُ, and Imam Malik, حُجَّةُ اللَّهِ عَلَىٰ خَلْقِهِ بَعْدَ التَّابِعِينَ, and indeed Imam Malik, he is the evidence and the proof of Allah upon his creation after the generation of the tabi'een. Imam Shafi'i, one day he commented on the book that was written by who? Imam Malik, called Al-Muwatta. So Muwatta Imam Malik was one of the most famous books of hadith ever written in the history of Islam. Imam Shafi'i commented on this book and he said, مَا بَعْدَ كِتَابِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى كِتَابٌ أَكْثَرُ صَوَابًا مِنْ مُوَطَّئِ إِمَامِ مَالِكِ. He said, عَلَيْهِ رَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ, there is no book that has ever been authored after, there is no book after the book of Allah, meaning the Qur'an, that has ever been authored that is more authentic than the Muwatta of Imam Malik. Of course, you have to appreciate the fact that this statement was made before Bukhari existed, before Imam Muslim existed. So this is during this time, of course, the Muwatta of Imam Malik was considered to be the most authentic book ever written when it comes to knowledge of Sunnah, knowledge of Hadith. The ulama, they say about Imam Malik, اعتمد الإمام في فتاواه على عدة مصادر. There are certain, what are the reference points and what are the sources of legislation that Imam Malik, he used when it came to his fatawa, when it came to his opinions. What were they for? What were the formulation? Where did it come from? Number one, Al-Qur'an. We already mentioned this, Abu Hanifa. Number two, As-Sunnah. Number three, Al-Ijma'. Okay, Al-Ijma'. Number four, Amalu Ahli Al-Madina. The actions and the traditions of the people of Medina. Imam Malik lived in Medina. So he lived in a time in which he saw and he met people from the Tabi'een. And he used to formulate many of the opinions based on the actions of these people. Why was that the case? Because according to Imam Malik, they inherited these traditions from who? The Tabi'een, the Sahaba. And the Sahaba got it from who? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So many a times you will find that Imam Malik, whenever he was formulating some of his opinions, he would give precedence to an action done by some of the people of Medina over an authentic hadith even. So he would say, what is his justification for that? He says, alayhi rahmatullah, I am not going to abandon the tradition that I have witnessed from many of the tabi'een who are living proof today, and take a solitary hadith which we don't know exactly the meaning, what it could entail. Whereas I can see the tabi'een who are in Medina alive today doing a certain action. So I take their tradition and I consider that to be from the Sahaba, and the Sahaba took that from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Also al-qiyas, using analogy, just like Imam Abu Hanifa, he was utilized analogy as well. It was mentioned, wulida fil Medina, he was born in Medina in the year 93. فَحَفِذَ الْقُرْآنِ, he memorized the Qur'an. في صدر حياته, when he was very young. So it's always we should understand, and it should always be a point, and it's something which is always going to be a recurring theme, that the people of the past, whenever you hear stories about people of knowledge of the past, there would always be people who memorized the Quran from a young age. They learned their Quran and they began their learning and their education about Islam from a young age. It wasn't something that they did later on. It was always something that they started from a young age. And they did what? They did something known as tadarruj, shay'an fa shay'an. After this, Imam Malik, when he finished the Quran, what did he do? He started to memorize a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَعِلْمِ الْفِقْهِ, and the different sciences, the science of Islamic jurisprudence. فَلَازَمَ الْعُلَمَاءِ, he stuck with the scholars and ulama who lived in Medina at that time. حَتَّى صَارَ مِنْ أَبْرَزِ الْعُلَمَاءِ, until he became amongst the greatest of the scholars that ever lived. عَلَى الْإِطْلَاقِ, meaning at all times. And Imam Malik radiallahu anhu, Allah is somebody whose name is mentioned till today with praise, with glorification. When you hear Imam Malik, subhanAllah, you're not going to ask anything twice. What did Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal mention about the book that was authored by Imam Malik that I already told you, the Muwatta of Imam Malik? He said, مَا أَحْسَنَهُ لِمَنْ تَدَيَّنَ بِهِ, how amazing is it for the person who acts by what is in that book. Anybody who chooses to base his life upon what's written on that book, then mashallah, tabarakallah, that's all that person would ever need. Imam Malik, one day he said to one of his students, Ibn Wahb, and this is one of the gems of Imam Malik, he said, اتَّقِ اللَّهِ, fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَاقْتَصِرْ عَلَىٰ عِلْمِكَ, and only speak about that which you have knowledge of. وَتَكَلَّمَ, oh, he said, وَاقْتَصِرْ عَلَىٰ عِلْمِكَ, only stay within the boundaries of that which you know. فَإِنَّهُ لَمْ يَقْتَصِرْ أَحَدٌ عَلَىٰ عِلْمِهِ إِلَّا نَفَعَ وَانْتَفَعَ, because anybody who does such a thing, he will benefit and he will benefit other people. So imagine that. Subhanallah. Something that many of us should take into consideration, that if we want to be people, okay, me and you, we want to be people who have influence. If you want to be people who are taken seriously, then speak that which you have authority to speak about. Anything beyond that, you leave, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make you amongst the greatest of the ulama. Somebody came to Imam Malik alayhi rahmatullah all the way from what? From Al-Maghrib. Some they say Al-Andalus, some they say Al-Maghrib, Al-Islami, from the West, okay? Somebody came, meaning he traveled months just to meet Imam Malik in Medina. And then he started to ask him he had many questions to ask him. And they mentioned about 40, 50, 45, somewhere around that number. And he only answered about 6 and 7, or 7. And the rest he would say, La Adri, I don't know. I can't answer that. La Adri, I don't know. And then he said, فَمَاذَا أَقُولُ لِلنَّاسِ What should I say to the people if I go back to them? They're expecting that the Imam Malik would know these questions. They said, قُولُوا لَهُمْ أَوْ قُلْ لَهُمْ أَنَّ مَالِكْ لَا يَدْرِي Tell them that Imam Malik doesn't know. Simple as that. Doesn't have to be complicated. Huh? We make things too complicated sometimes. He said, tell him that I don't know. Simple as that. If I knew, I would have given the answer, but I don't know. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose Imam Malik to be somebody who would be from the greatest ulama ever mentioned in our religion. Did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ever mention anything about Imam Malik? Did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mention anything about Imam Malik? There's a narration in a hadith collected by At-Tirmidhi in his Sunan. It's also collected by Ibn Hibban, this narration. An Abi Hurairata, narrated a hadith narrated by Abu Hurairata radiyallahu anhu. He said, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. He said that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, يوشك أن يضرب الرجل أكباد الإبل في طلب العلم. He said, a time will come in which a person will strike the liver of a camel seeking knowledge, meaning traveling to a faraway land just to seek knowledge. And he said, فلا يجد. This is the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم speaking. He said, فَلَا يَجِدُ He will not find عَالِمًا One scholar أَعْلَمُ مِنْ عَالِمِ الْمَدِينَةِ He will not find one scholar more knowledgeable than the scholar of Medina. Than the scholar of Medina. إِسْحَاقِ بْنْ مُوسَى عَلَيْهِ رَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ He said, فَبَلَغَنِي It reached me عَنْ ابن جُرَيْج That Ibn Jurayj said, أَنَّهُ كَانَ يَقُولُ That he would say, نرى أنه مالك بن أنس We regard this hadith to be speaking about مالك بن أنس Imam Malik يحيى بن معين Who was one of the best friends of Imam Ahmed بن Hanbal What did he say? He said سمعت I heard سفيان بن عيينة saying نظن أنه مالك بن أنس We consider this hadith to be speaking about Malik ibn Anas, Imam Malik. So imagine the Prophet ﷺ mentioned Abu Hanifa and he also mentioned Imam Malik as well. So imagine, subhanallah, a tazkiyah or a certification that's given by the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ. Is there any certification more golden? Is there any certification more worthy than one which the Prophet ﷺ has given you? When the Prophet ﷺ tells you this person is somebody of knowledge, then subhanallah, and no need for anybody to question anything after that. And that's what Prophet said both about Abu Hanifa, and he mentioned the same thing about Imam Malik alayhi rahmatullah. So then why is it that many people nowadays, unfortunately, they don't take these imams very seriously? They don't. When you want to learn, you say, people, subhanallah, you have to realize one thing that's very, very important. The knowledge that they came with wasn't a solitary opinion that they had. And this is one of the biggest misconceptions that exist today. People assume that when you say the madhab of Abu Hanifa, it's the opinions of Abu Hanifa. People think that when you say the madhab of Imam Malik, it's the opinions of Imam Malik. You assume that when you say the madhab of Shafi'i, it means the opinions of Imam Shafi'i. When people assume and say the madhab of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, they assume these are the opinions of Imam Ahmad, and that cannot be further from reality. These are schools and institutes, okay? That was coded, the only reason that it has the name of the Imam that founded it was because he was the one who codified it. That's the only relationship it has with the Imam. The only relationship that the madhab of Imam Abu Hanifa has with Imam Abu Hanifa is because he was the one who codified it and he was the one who introduced the principles. That's it. Same with Malik, same with Shafi'i, same with Ahmad ibn Hanbal. As for the opinions of the school itself, it came from thousands and thousands and thousands of scholars, a tradition that goes more than 1,000 years. So you can possibly, it could possibly be said today that the madhab of Imam Shafi'i only maybe one third or one fourth of the entire madhab cannot be attributed to Imam Shafi'i. One third goes to other scholars. Similarly, the same could be said about all of the other madhahib. So I just wanted to take that misconception away from many of the people who think that, okay, Abu Hanifa, Abu Hanifa, that's it. That's not what it means. That's not what it means. And this is something that we need to understand very carefully. Okay? So we need to get this misconception out of our minds. These are traditions that existed since the early days of Islam. And even these a'immah, they took this knowledge from the Sahaba. Everything that they made, everything that was based from their fatawa was knowledge either that was taken from where? From the Sahaba and the earlier generations that came before them. Or they were using their principles and their methodology in order to extract what? These masail and these new ijtihadat that came around during the time in which they lived. The next imam, he died alayhi rahmatullah in the year, I already mentioned, in the year 179, and he died out of because of a sickness that he suffered for 22 days before he passed away alayhi rahmatullah, Imam Malik. And then he was buried in Al-Baqi', which is just outside of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam's masjid in Medina al-Nabawiyyah, in the city of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The third imam I want to speak about is Abu Abdullah Muhammad ibn Idris al-Shafi'i alayhi rahmatullah, who was born in the year 150, who died in the year 204, meaning he only lived for 54 years. Imam al-Shafi'i alayhi rahmatullah, he only had a life of 54 years, imagine. And look at the impact that he left on this world before he's gone, before he left. Subhanallah. It's mentioned, huwa mu'assisu ilm usul al-fiqh. He was the one who introduced the science of usul al-fiqh. Usul al-fiqh before Imam al-Shafi'i was something that could be found in the Quran and in the Sunnah that was fragmented and didn't exist as a separate science. But he was the one who codified it in a book called Ar-Risala, and he was the one who introduced the science for the generations till today. People who learn usul al-fiqh, the first person who authored a book in it was Imam al-Shafi'i alayhi rahmah, during his life. Of course, the showing you that if you have himma, if you have a degree of desire to learn your religion, you can do so. Many of these a'imma I'm telling you about, Imam Ahmad was an orphan. They say Imam Malik the same. Imam Shafi'i grew in abject poverty. He grew in abject poverty. Yet these issues or problems that existed didn't prevent them from learning the religion. So what excuse do you have today for you? I'm in high school, but I have college. I got uni, wallahi, things are difficult. I work 9 to 5 every single day. Imagine not having food. Imagine, subhanallah al-azim, every single day not knowing where your next ration of food would come from. That's the kind of lives that these imams used to live, subhanallah. That's the kind of life that they used to live. But that never prevented them. They never said, I need to go, how can I learn about the religion and learn about Allah and this and whatever when I don't even have food? I don't even know I'm going to get my next ration of food today. Is that what prevented them from learning about the religion? That's not. In fact, that was the catalyst that made them want to learn more about religion. Why is Allah subhanahu, how is the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala determined? How does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make his decrees? They wanted to learn, so they were inquisitive. So this is how they started learning about their religion. And that's what made them the great people that they are today. Today we're here in London, subhanAllah, speaking about who they were. And they died how many years ago? How many centuries ago did they go? That should show you that if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keeps a mention of a people alive, it means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala approves of these people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala thinks well of them. What was the dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam? What was the dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam for himself? Ibrahim alayhi salam, he made a lot of ad'iyas, huh? He made a lot of supplications. But there's one supplication that he made for himself. He said, وَجَعَلِّي لِسَانَ صِدِقٍ فِي الْآخِرِينَ. Oh Allah, give me a good mention for the later generations. Let me not be remembered in an evil way. Let me be remembered for khair. So this is something which is important. What do you want your legacy to be tomorrow? Do you just want to be the person who learned how to play football and then khalas, you became a football player? Maybe if we say, mashallah, you become a professional football player tomorrow, then alhamdulillah, is that what you want your legacy to be? What will determine, what about your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What about you? Some people want to become a movie star, huh? Maybe a film star. Yes, it's true. Some people want to do other things. But where is your good mention going to lie? What will benefit you in the hereafter? What will be the thing that gives you success on the day of judgment? These are how they used to think. So this is how we should also think. He was born alayhi rahmatullah in the year 150. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal once described Imam Ahmad and he said, كَانَ الشَّافِعِيُّ كَالشَّمْسِ لِلدُّنْيَا. Imam al-Shafi'i was like the sun for the earth. Imagine the relationship between the sun and the earth. Can the earth survive without the sun? وَكَالْعَافِيَةِ لِلْبَدَنِ. And like medication for the body. That's how we regard Imam al-Shafi'i. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal is the one saying that. Nobody can determine the virtue. We'll stop for the adhan, inshallah. Continuing, inshallah, where we left off. Was Imam al-Shafi'i, was he, alayhi rahmatullah, mentioned by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? It was mentioned, ruwiya anil Nabiya sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, Allahumma hdi Quraishan, O Allah, guide the Quraysh, fa inna alimaha yamla'u tabaq al-ardi ilma. Oh Allah, guide the Quraysh, for indeed their scholar will fill the earth with knowledge. Will fill the earth with knowledge. Now who is the scholar of Quraysh? Imam al-Shafi'i, because he was from the Quraysh. He was from the tribe of Banu al-Muttalib. Imam Abdul Malik ibn Muhammad Abu Nu'aym, he said, هذه الصفة, this description by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, la tantabiqu illa ala al-Shafi'i. These attributes can only be seen to be talking and speaking about Imam al-Shafi'i. Also, one day Imam al-Shafi'i, he decided to go on a trip. Okay, he wanted to leave to Egypt. So that's where he was going to die. So in the year 199 Hijri, he decided that he will go to Egypt. He said in some lines of poetry, فَوَاللَّهِ مَا أَدْرِي, by Allah, I really don't know. أَلِلْفَوْزُ وَالْغِنَى أُسَاقُ إِلَيْهَا أَمْ أُسَاقُ إِلَى الْقَبْرِ. I really don't know. Is it to success that I'm being driven, or am I being driven over there to my grave? Then it was said by the scholars later on, فَوَاللَّهِ by Allah, لَقَدْ سِيقَ إِلَيْهِمَا جَمِيعًا. He was driven to both of that. He was driven to his fame and he was also driven to his death. Only 5 years later after traveling there did he pass away عليه رحمة الله وتوفي رحمه الله تعالى. He died عليه رحمة الله in the year 204. As for Abu Abdullah Ahmad ibn Muhammad ibn Hanbal al-Shaybani عليه رحمة الله, also known as Imam Ahmad, was born in the year 164 and he died in the year 241. The ulama, they used to say about him, كَانَ مَعْرُوفًا بِالْأَخْلَاقِ الْحَسَنَةِ. He was known to have very good etiquettes and good manners. كَالصَّبْرِ, like patience. وَالتَّوَاضُعِ, and to have very, very humble, and humbleness. وَالتَّسَامُحِ, and he was often very, very forgiving. Imam al-Shafi'i one day said about him, خَرَجْتُ مِن بَغْدَادِ, I left Baghdad, the city of Baghdad. وَمَا خَلَّفْتُ بِهَا أَحَدًا أَوْرَعُ وَلَا أَتْقَى وَلَا أَفْقَهُ مِنْ أَحْمَدِ بْنِ حَنْبَلٍ. When I left there, I didn't leave anybody who was more devout, more pious, and more knowledgeable in Islamic jurisprudence than Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. He was born, as I mentioned, in the year 164 in Baghdad, and he was what? A orphan from a young age. وَنَشَأَ فِيهَا يَتِيمًا. He was a orphan, subhanAllah. Did that prevent him from learning his religion? Did that prevent him from trying to develop a relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? It didn't do so. But then what excuse do we have? We don't run out of excuses, most of us. But they didn't use any of the, if the ones who actually had real excuses would have been them, but they didn't use those as excuses. But unfortunately, us who don't actually have legitimate excuses try and use many, many things which cannot be used as an excuse as an excuse. Ishtahara, he became very famous because of his knowledge, especially during his mihna. The word mihna means fitna. It means a trial when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests him. Indeed, when Allah if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves the people, ibtalahum, Allah tests them. As was mentioned in the hadith collected by At-Tirmidhi in the Sunan. He was tested when the Khalifa at that time went to force everybody to say and mention that the Quran, the word of Allah, wasn't actually the word of Allah. It wasn't the spoken word of Allah. So it was something which was makhluq or created, meaning that Allah didn't speak the Quran. So this caused a lot of havoc at that time and anarchy in the society at that time. Many of the ulama opposed. Among them was Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. Fuhubis, he was imprisoned. Wa'udhib, and he was tortured. After having sustained that level of punishment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala willed for him, just like he willed for Yusuf alayhi salam, to leave the prison. Thumma akhraja, he left prison. وَدَعَى إِلَى التَّدْرِيسِ, and then he continues, وَعَادَ إِلَى التَّدْرِيسِ وَالتَّحَدِيثِ, he returned back to teaching hadith and teaching all of the other sciences. الرَّبِيعُ ibn Sulaiman says something amazing about Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. He said, قَالَ لَنَا الشَّافِعِ, Imam al-Shafi'i, he said to us, أَحْمَدْ إِمَامٌ فِي ثَمَانِ خِصَالِ. Ahmad, or Imam Ahmad, was an Imam in 8 different sciences. One of us, subhanAllah, we learn a little bit of Quran, we get so excited. Imam Ahmad was an imam, meaning number one in 8 different sciences. He says, imamun fil hadith. He was number one when it came to hadith. He was the number one leader in hadith. Imamun fil fiqh. Imam in Islamic jurisprudence. Imamun fil lugha. Imam in the science of the Arabic language. Imam fi al-Qur'an, he was the imam and the leader when it comes to knowledge of Qur'an. He was the imam, he was imamun fi al-faqr. He was the imam even in poverty. There was no one who was more poor than him. Imagine being an imam in poverty. Imamun fi al-zuhud, he was an imam in asceticism. Asceticism meaning when you do taqleelun min al-dunya, you're not really focused on dunya. You don't really take dunya into consideration. Imam fil wara, being devout to Allah, he was an imam in that science. Imam fil sunnah, he was an imam also in the sunnah. That's 8 sciences. This is mentioned in the book called Tabaqatul Hanabila, written by Ibn al-Jawzi alayhi rahmatullah. One day somebody also said, Imam al-Shafi'i said about him, this is what I'm going to conclude with this inshaAllah. Thalathatun min ajaib al-zaman. 3 things that I've seen in my life. Who's saying this? Imam al-Shafi'i. 3 things that I've seen in my life that I consider to be the wonders of the world. Imam al-Shafi'i, he's seen some wonders of the world. 3 things he saw that astonished him. And to somebody like Imam al-Shafi'i will not get astonished very easily. But he said, 3 things astonished me. He said, number one, Arabi la yu'rabu kalima. Somebody who's an Arab who doesn't know how to do I'rab. I'rab meaning he doesn't know the intricacies of Arabic grammar. وَهُوَ أَبُو ثَوْرٌ, and he was the great scholar Abu Thawr. He said about Abu Thawr, he's Arab, but he doesn't know the technicalities and the intricacies of the Arabic language. وَهُوَ أَبُو ثَوْرٌ, and he said, وَأَعْجَمِي, and number two, an أَعْجَمِي, someone who was not an Arab. لَا يُخْطِئُ فِي كَلِمَةٍ, he doesn't make any mistake in the language. Someone who's not an Arab, but he doesn't make a single mistake. وَهُوَ حَسَنُ الزَّعْفَرَانِ And he was who? Hassan al-Za'farani. Hassan al-Za'farani was the student of Imam Shafi'i. And then he said, last, وَسَغِيرٌ And someone extremely young in age, very young in age, كُلَّمَا قَالَ شَيْئًا Whenever he says something, صَدَّقَهُ الْكِبَارُ All of the elderly scholars will all be very humble and agree with him. He's young, but whenever he speaks, everyone, all of the elders and all everybody will listen to what he has to say. وَهُوَ أَحْمَدُ بِنَ حَنْبَلَ And he's Ahmed ibn Hanbal, عَلَيْهِ رَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ And this was mentioned in the book, if you want to go back to it, مَنَاقِبُ الْإِمَامِ Ahmed, The Virtues of Imam Ahmed, written by Ibn al-Jawzi. We'll end with that, inshallah. He died, عَلَيْهِ رَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ on a Friday, in a time of duha. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses the best time to take his pious slaves. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among the pious slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa sallallahu wa sallim ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in walhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.
Indeed, it is only the knowledgeable among his servants who truly fear Allah. Middle Path Radio, your source of Islamic knowledge.